Steerforth Press presents Ruse, Lying the American Dream from Hollywood to Wall Street, written and narrated by Robert Kerbeck. To my mother, who always told me to tell the truth. We have given away so much information that anyone, anywhere, can become anybody at any time. Frank Abagnale, catch me if you can. With that little black phone, you can achieve anything. That phone equals money. Jordan Belfort, the Wolf of Wall Street. Is it not monstrous that this player here, but in a fiction, in a dream of passion, could force his soul so to his own conceit? William Shakespeare, Hamlet. Author's note. This memoir tells the true story of my life. While I've used the real names of celebrities, I've changed the names and identifying details of many of the other characters and companies in order to protect their privacy. I've relied on my own memory, such as it is, to reconstruct events and to capture the spirit of what actually occurred. Most of the time, I think I've succeeded. Prologue. The CEO of Big Daddy's Surf Shack. Phone to my ear. I listen to it ring the way a stage actor, surging with adrenaline, counts the final seconds to his cue. Eyes closed, I breathe in sync with it. A woman picks up on the fourth ring. I recognize the voice and feel the tension in my knuckles relax a bit. My eyes pop open and I hit my mark. Hey, Zoe, it's Kevin in compliance. Hi, Kev, she says. How you doing? I ask. My Philly accent like a fist tapping at the window. The cancer's back. It pains me to hear this. I've been calling Zoe for more than a decade, and she's never been anything less than incredibly helpful. I count on her to help me do my job and do it well. Though we've never met, I like her and feel like we know each other. I hate the idea of her getting sick and leaving the company, one of the largest financial institutions in the world. Among other things, it means my work will get much more challenging. I need her to look up the name, title, and cell phone number for a high-level executive at the bank, plus the names and numbers of everyone who reports to him. She's provided this type of information to me dozens of times over the years. I'm kind of in a hurry, but I'm not an asshole. I need to hear about her illness first. I'm sorry to hear that, Zoe. What's the situation? It's not good, she says. I can tell she's going to say something else, and I'm pretty sure I know what it is. She's going to share with me how much time she has left. I can hear it in her pauses. After so many years working the phones, I've learned to pick out the nuances, the things being said behind what's being said, entire life stories even, in a hesitation or vocal inflection, in blank moments in time. Hey, I had a friend who was down for the count, and he's still around 5 years later, I say. They're coming up with new treatments every day. You've just got to stick around and they'll find something. I'm on a new chemical now. See? Don't you worry. You and I will be having these chats for years to come. I mean it. She knows I do. I can hear it in the whisper of a smile on the other end of the line. A few years ago, after she got divorced, Zoe tried to initiate a little flirtation. I was game. Among other things, that kind of rapport would help grease the wheels when I needed help with something. Are you single? She'd asked. I am at the moment. Do you ever visit Dallas? No, I said. Working in compliance, I only get to travel to state capitals to meet with regulators. Austin is as close as I get. My daughter has a softball tournament in Austin this weekend. Are you still going to be there Friday? You could stay on. It would be fun to finally meet you. I wish. But I'm out of here tonight as soon as we file these docs, then on to the next capital for more of the same. Darn it, she said. Maybe next time. For sure. Zoe didn't stay single long. Once she remarried, our chats focused on my miserable, lonely days traveling around to please uptight state regulators. Zoe often reminded me that my life shouldn't all be about work. And she does it again now, after my reassurance that we've got a lot of collaboration ahead of us. I hope I'll be around long enough to see you getting out there more, Zoe says. You and me both, I say. And my tone cues her that we need to get down to the real purpose of my call, What do you need, Kev? I sigh something along the lines of, this may be painful, but we're in it together, and give her the name of a senior executive. I need to know his entire organization from top to bottom, every name all the way down to the junior analyst level, plus each individual's location and cell phone number. I need to understand the reporting lines, the company's organizational chart, so I can highlight who's in charge of what and who the heavy hitters are. Zoe knows I'm off-site and don't have access to any of this information at the moment. Wow, she says as she pulls up the name on the bank's internal database. He has over 200 people in his group. This is going to take forever. I worry Zoe is going to tell me that she has her own job to do and doesn't have time for this, that she may be dead by the time she gives me everything I need. Instead, she says, you ready? I smile to myself and nod, pen in hand. Go for it. Zoe reads me all the names and titles, tells me who each person reports to, who has teams, and who is on each team. She gives me precise descriptions of what each team does and offers each individual's cell number and physical location. My hand cramps as I scribble everything down. By the time she finishes, more than an hour has passed. I thank her earnestly. I've got to take a break after that, Zoe says. I'm exhausted. You deserve one, I say. She deserves more than that. An expensive dinner on me, or hell, an all-expenses-paid vacation to Hawaii. But I can't do that. I certainly can't physically go see her in Dallas. I have to keep things professional. Zoe knows that what I do is critical for our multi-billion dollar company to continue doing what it does. So she provides what I ask of her over and over, year after year, even though it has absolutely nothing to do with her job, even though it eats up hours of her time, even though she is not authorized to give me any of that information. And, most important, even though every single thing she knows about me and everything I've ever told her is a lie. My name is not Kevin, and I don't work in compliance. I am not an employee of Zoe's company, let alone an executive. I've never met a state regulator, uptight or otherwise. I am not sitting in an antiseptic office in a blocky municipal building in Austin. I've got my feet up on my desk in the converted tool shed that is my home office in Malibu. The sign on the door says Big Daddy's Surf Shop, though I've always just called it the Shack. Shirtless, in board shorts and flip-flops, I gaze out at the Pacific and breathe in its familiar salty musk while I casually manipulate her. I am not single. My wife's in the house doing yoga. It's not even true that I'm not an asshole. Well, okay, I'm not. But viewed through the lens of cajoling a woman suffering from cancer into giving me private company information that could get her fired, while pushing her to provide it in time for me to catch some waves before the late afternoon wind comes up, one could be forgiven for thinking such. My friend who survived cancer? That actually is true. Every good liar knows you need to throw in one big truth to anchor the rest of the bullshit. But all that internal data about reporting structures and titles and top earners? One of the largest search firms in the world has secretly hired me to steal it. And those private cell phone numbers? My client is going to target the bank's best moneymakers and try to poach them, securing their meaty portfolios as well. It's late 2006 and Wall Street is bursting. Year-end bonuses are projected to be 10 to 25% higher than last year's, netting the top bankers and traders as much as $40 million apiece. Meanwhile, a couple of hundred miles south of Zoe, in Houston, former Enron CEO Jeffrey K. Skilling has just been sentenced to 24 years in prison and fined $45 million for his part in one of the greatest bankruptcy and accounting scandals in American history. "We are the good guys," he infamously said. All of which is to say, this seemingly innocuous phone call is taking place in a capitalist ecosystem defined by outrageous, unchecked excess and, yes, rampant deception. The world of corporate spying is shady but lucrative, and I am one of the best. Very few can do what I do. I am the CEO of a thriving underground enterprise that I've been building for almost 20 years. As a professional telephone liar, the last of a dying breed. I operate in a shadow market pursuing corporate intelligence worth billions of dollars to the top firms in the cutthroat world of international finance. And for a corporate spy, there is nothing on this earth better than a reliable mole. Finding one as good and as gullible as Zoe, a low-level paper pusher, doesn't happen every day. Indeed, she is the longest-running mole I've ever had. Most of my research calls start with someone new. I have to convince them, though it's more like I hypnotize them, that I am who I say I am. Then I have to get them to believe I'm off-site, working in a building that's been reinforced with so much steel because of post-9/11 security concerns that my cell phone is having trouble accessing our firm's internal...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.